at the garage. There's a bit of a shift around going on. From Chevettes. To Corniche. Space is being made for one of the most flamboyant cars to ever grace the concrete bit of the Matthewson showroom.
Look at that.
This outrageous machine is an Excalibur Roadster from 1970. It was the brainchild of Studebaker designer Brooks Stevens, who wanted to produce a 1930s-looking car, but with 60s tech. Styled on the classic Mercedes SSK, which itself was designed by Ferdinand Porsche, it's a replica car with a huge pedigree and a small block V8. The rich and famous fell for their Hollywood glamour. They cost a small fortune, but they are no toy. Well made, with an engine that sings to a very American tune.
Well, let's be fair, it's kind of got all the right bits, hasn't it? You know, a big burbling V8, great big chassis, not as heavy as a truck, triple wipers, you know? You don't see sports cars with triple wipers, do you?
A candy-coloured clown they call the Sandman tiptoes to my room every night.
But what separates this car from the crowd isn't just its power and styling. It's the presence given to it by the man who owned it first.
I close my eyes.
The Excalibur's original owner was Roy Orbison.
It's a magnificent thing, isn't it? You know, if you're into something a bit flash and a bit different, there it is, isn't it?
And the provenance will make a difference to somebody.
It will to someone. Kawaii and half.
The big O liked his cars and bikes and had an impressive collection. Just like the big D.
Here we are, mate. Bah, she looks big now she's out, don't she? Isn't she a big wide thing? Right, cracking looking old bus, isn't it? Do you like it? Isn't it just, yeah. Belongs to Roy Orbison, you know.
Yeah, he bought it new.
Yeah.
Whether a famous former owner adds value depends on the level of fame. And Roy is adding value.
He drove it all night, that.
When he was crying.
Yeah. I drove it all night to get to you.
Are you a Roy Orbison fan?
I do like Roy Orbison, yeah. Music.
Not his car.
Oh, I like his car as well. Yeah.
But you need the paperwork. Provenance is everything. And Derek's all over it.
Excalibur since 1964. This vehicle was purchased by Roy Orbison from Excalibur Sales Incorporated, Milwaukee, Wisconsin, 14th of August 1970. How about that?
So it's the real deal?
It's the real deal.
You a big fan?
I am, big fan. When he sings, he looks as though he's maybe straining a bit, but he's actually not. It's just the way he is, you know. And I've heard him sing some ballads. Brilliant, you know.
A reserve has been agreed with the owners.
Submit the best bid with an indication that it's got to be above 15.
But the spirit of Roy will play a part, and it could be higher.
Where would he have been cruising down in this? Where would he have been with this, then?
According to his dressy, it was Tennessee, wasn't it, I think, somewhere? But I would imagine he must have spent most of his time on the West Coast, wouldn't he? Cruising about of an evening time with his glasses on, in disguise. Yeah, he didn't want to stand out at all, so he thought he'd just take the Excalibur. So no one would take any notice, would they, of a beautiful white Excalibur driving down the West Coast Highway or whatever it's called with someone that looks like Roy Orbison in it with a pair of sunglasses. Who would have bothered looking? Oh, yeah.
Playtime over. It's auction day, and an important one at that. Roy Orbison's car won't sell itself.
You're looking at a piece of history, aren't you?
That's absolutely amazing. Amazing car.
If I had the money, that'd go home with me.
The vendor, Stacey Turnbull, is here, with husband Will.
That's my last chance to be in it, really.
Her parents, Hayden and Pamela, bought this car in Miami.
It was my dad's, yes. He bought it in America at an auction. He's always been a massive fan of Roy Orbison. And apparently Elvis Presley sat in this. That's what my dad was told at the auction as well.
Yeah, because they were friends.
Because they were friends.
Stacey's mum and dad passed away last year. Keeping the car isn't an option.
And we just don't have the space. We couldn't even get it in our garage.
Too big.
Yeah, yeah, it's too wide. Yeah. I just hope someone who will appreciate it, you know, and carry it on. Just hoping it does well.
Yeah.
Excalibur, what a car.
Who's Royals?
I'm joking, I think he's the greatest singer ever lived. I think he's fantastic. 1970, start me on it. There we are. 15, 15, 5, 16, 5, 16, 5, 17, 5, 17,500, 18, 18,000, 18. Is the 5 anywhere? 18, 18, 5. Find another one. Find another one like this. You never will you? 18, 5. 19, Jack's phone, 19. 19, 5. 19, 5. Jack's phone, 20. Yep, 20,500, Meg's phone. 21. 21,000, Jack's phone, 21. 21,000, sold and gone. 21,500, 21,500, Meg's phone. You gotta buy it, you never find another, will you? 22,000. 22,500, 22,500, she says. Meg's phone, are you sure you're done? Thank you very much for your bidding. 23,500, thank you very much. And that wants a round of applause, well done. 23,500. Well done. 23,500.
A phone bidder bags the Excalibur. The car will soon be on its way down south for a bit of fettling. After that, the mighty 5.7-litre engine will be fired up and it will be let loose on the roads of Kent. As for the Mercedes SS-inspired Excalibur, it's had a couple of months of light restoration down in Kent.
Looks good, eh?
And today, new owner David South and his daughter, Joanne, have arrived to pick it up from mechanic Luke King.
How'd you get off?
Yeah, it's all good. It's all ready to go. New brakes, calipers, as you can see, new hoses.
We did some new chrome in here, didn't we?
Yeah, we've had these top arms chromed.
Yeah.
Just because they're on show, it's better, looks better.
David has a collection of high-end cars, but the provenance of this one sets it apart from the rest.
Knowing that it was Roy Orbison's just makes it a little bit more special. This was obviously a car he loved. It's done 44,000, 45,000 miles, so it has been used. There's still a plate on the back that says Roy Orbison. I should be taking it off, really, but I think I'm going to leave it.
Roy specced up some 70s bookshelf speakers to listen to his cassettes on. But another quirky standard fitting has been revealed.
We found that the petrol tank was in fact a big rubber bag made by Dunlop, obviously built as a petrol tank, which I think they do a bit in boats and things like that. But Luke's managed to get a proper aluminium tank put in its place.
It's got new exhaust manifolds because they're all blowing.
Okay.
So they're all done, it sounds good. So yeah, that's where we're at with the car, ready for you to take.
Drives all right, you've had it up and down the road a bit?
Yeah, yeah, drives lovely.
Does it make a lot of noise? That's what I want to know.
Yes, it does make lots of noise.
David knows what to expect.
I do have another Excalibur, believe it or not. It's a much bigger car than this in size. It's a four-seater. It was made specifically as a present from the US Navy for the governor of the Philippines for allowing them to have their warships and things there after the war. It was built from 12-gauge battleship steel, so consequently weighs 5.5 tonnes. It's like trying to stop an oil tanker.
Excalibur number 2 has had about $5,000 worth of renovation done to it so far. The original 50-year-old Chevy V8 needed next to no attention.
It sounds great, and you can just tell from the throttle that it's really waiting to get a shift on. It has power steering, but you've got to be able to drive it, not just sit behind the wheel and steer it. I know we should be thinking of environmental electric cars and all that kind of stuff, but they do little mileage, and it's just that childhood dream, really. I'm very lucky, of 9 grandchildren, and they're all taking turns of picking which car they want when I'm gone. So no one's picked this one yet, but I'm expecting one of them to.